Hello students, today's topic is immunochemical techniques 1. Here we will be covering the production of polyclonal and monoclonal antibodies by hybridoma technology. Coming to the introduction, what are immunochemical techniques? Immunochemical techniques include both experimental methods to study the immune system and methods to generate or use immunological reagents as experimental tools. The most common immunological methods relates to the production and use of antibodies to detect specific proteins in biological samples. Now, what is an antibody? Antibodies, also known as immunoglobulins, are Y-shaped proteins that are produced by the immune system. They are recruited by the immune system to identify and neutralize antigens or foreign bodies like bacteria and viruses. Polyclonal antibodies are antibodies that are secreted by different B cell lineages within the body. They are a collection of immunoglobulin molecules that react against a specific antigen, each identifying a different epitope. These antibodies target different epitopes or binding sites on a single antigen, whereas monoclonal antibodies come from a single cell lineage. Coming to the immune response overview, we know that there are two different immune responses, humoral and cell mediated response. Humoral response involves the activation of B cells that is converted to plasma cells, which secretes antibodies. During a humoral response, the antigens are separated into small pieces due to antigen presenting cells and are detected by B cells. During this activation process, B cells differentiate into plasma cells, massively producing and secreting a single type of antibody. There are many different types of antibodies produced because antigens in general possess a variety of epitopes. The various types of antibodies secreted from a plasma cells are called a polyclonal antibody. On the other hand, monoclonal antibody is a single type of antibody that is produced from a single type of plasma cell. Coming to polyclonal antibody, the first step of polyclonal antibody production is to immunize mouse, rabbit, or goat with antigen to produce antibody against that antigen. The polyclonal antibody that is produced is then drawn from the blood of the animal. The general procedure to produce polyclonal antibodies is as follows. First one is antigen preparation. Second one is adjuvant selection and preparation. Third one, animal selection. Fourth, injection process. Fifth is blood serum extraction. Coming to the first one, that is antigen preparation. Small polypeptides and non-protein antigens generally need to be conjugated or cross-linked to larger immunogenic carrier proteins to increase immunogenicity. Generally, the larger the immunogenic protein, the better is the immune response. Larger proteins, even if it is present in small amounts, usually results in better engagement of antigen presenting and antigen processing cells for a better immune response. Second one is adjuvant selection and preparation. The antigen is injected into the host, which is recognized by the immune system as foreign, and it is targeted by antibodies for immune blockage or clearance. Failure to mount an immune response would require the use of adjuvants, immunogenic substances such as Fruen's adjuvant or keyhole limpet hemocyanin, or also known as KLH, to further drive the immune recruitment. The third procedure is the animal selection. Animals frequently used for polyclonal antibody production includes goat, chickens, guinea pigs, hamsters, horses, mice, rats, and sheep. However, rabbit is the most commonly used laboratory animal for this purpose. Fourth one is the injection process. Initial host exposure to antigen with appropriate adjuvants is termed as prime immunization. Typical methods of exposure include injection into the skin, peritoneum, subcutaneous layer, or muscle. Less common alternatives are oral and intranasal administration. Any subsequent exposure to antigen is termed a boost immunization. All antibody generation, polyclonal or monoclonal, begins with eliciting an immune response, which is termed as immunization. Immunization comprises the majority of what is required to make polyclonal antibodies. Macrophages, dendritic cells, and to a lesser extent B cells are antigen presenting cells. They can internalize antigen by endocytosis or phagocytosis. Antigen processing breaks the antigen into smaller pieces, which are then moved to the surface of the antigen presenting cells. Recognition of antigen presented on the surface of the antigen presenting cells induces the release of stimulatory signaling molecules like cytokines from helper T cells. These cytokines activate B cells. The B cells recognize the antigen through their B cell receptor. Activated B cells divide to create both memory B cells and plasma cell populations. Plasma cells secrete antibodies into the serum for immune recognition, while memory B cells persist for a longer period, providing quick response to secondary exposure of the same antigen. Next is blood serum extraction. The whole blood drawing can be conducted before the fourth immunization if the titer is high. Polyclonal antibody production merely requires the recovery of blood from the host animal and separation of the cellular fraction from the serum fraction containing the secreted antibodies. As many antigen-specific antibodies are secreted by multiple activated B cells, blood serum contains the many products of different antibody clones, hence the term polyclonal antibody. Measuring the antibody levels during immunization process is required to evaluate the progress. An ELISA against the target antigen compares the immunized serum samples to the pre-immunized serum sample, revealing the degree of immune response driven by immunization. Serial dilutions of samples determine the titer of the antibody. Typically, a 1 is to 64,000 titer is considered a robust immune response and sufficient for proceeding to serum harvest or lymphocyte fusion. Lower titers may require subsequent boost immunizations, alternative routes of administration, or additional adjuvants. There are certain advantages and disadvantages of polyclonal antibody. Few advantages are: they are quick to produce as purified antibody will be ready to use in under 4 months. They are easy to store, higher overall antibody affinity against the antigen due to recognition of multiple epitopes. Few disadvantages are, they have higher potential for cross-reactivity due to recognizing multiple epitopes. And affinity purification of the serum will typically be required to minimize the cross-reactivity. Coming to the polyclonal antibody application. Polyclonal antibody response facilitates the localization, phagocytosis, and complement-mediated lysis of antigen. Next is monoclonal antibody. They are the antibodies that are made by identical immune cells that are all clones of a unique parent cell. Monoclonal antibodies can have monovalent affinity in that they bind to the same epitope. In contrast, polyclonal antibodies bind to multiple epitopes and are usually made by several different plasma cell lineages. By fusing a normal activated antibody producing B cells with a myeloma cells, that is a cancerous plasma cell, they were able to generate a hybrid cell called as hybridoma, which possessed the immortal growth properties of the myeloma cell and secreted the antibody produced by the B cell. The resulting clones of hybridoma cells, which secrete large quantities of monoclonal antibody, can be cultured indefinitely. Most antigens offer multiple epitopes and therefore induce proliferation and differentiation of a variety of B cell clones, each derived from a B cell that recognizes a particular epitope. The resulting serum antibodies are heterogeneous, comprising a mixture of antibodies, each specific for one epitope. In 1975, George Koehler and Caesar Milstein devised a method for preparing monoclonal antibody, which quickly became one of the immunology key technologies. The significance of the work by Koehler and Milstein was acknowledged when each was awarded a Nobel Prize. Coming to hybridoma technology. This technology was developed by Koehler and Milstein in 1975, and it has been widely used for the production of monoclonal antibodies. In this technique, they selected a population of malignant plasma cells unable to secrete immunoglobulins and also deficient in the enzyme hypoxanthine guanine phosphoribosyl transferase, or also known as SGPRT. SGPRT is an enzyme necessary for the salvage pathway of nucleic acid synthesis. The malignant cells are then fused or hybridized with freshly harvested spleen cells from a mouse recently immunized with antigen. The fusion is often accompanied by the use of polyethylene glycol or PEG. When the nuclei are fused, the hybridoma cells then possess both the capacity to manufacture immunoglobulin and the ability to survive in culture in a selected medium such as that containing hypoxanthine, aminopterin and thymidine, or simply known as HAT medium. The myeloma cells are SGPRT deficient, and also the de novo nucleotide pathway is blocked by aminopterin. So the unfused myeloma cells cannot grow because they lack SGPRT enzyme and thus cannot replicate their DNA. The unhybridized B cells, which is SGPRT positive, survives, but after some cell division it undergo a normal cell death. But the hybridized cells have HGPRT enzymes from B cells, so they can continuously grow in a large scale culture. Those hybrid cells synthesizing specific antibody are selected by some tests for antigen reactivity, for example ELISA, and then cloned from single cells and propagated in tissue culture. The hybridoma can be grown indefinitely in a suitable cell culture medium. They can also be injected into mice in the peritoneal cavity around the gut, where they produce tumors secreting antibody rich fluid called ascite fluid. Coming to the application of monoclonal antibodies. First one is, monoclonal antibodies are proving to be very useful as diagnostic, imaging and therapeutic reagents in clinical medicine. Second, they are used primarily as in vitro diagnostic reagents. Monoclonal antibody diagnostic reagents now available are products for detecting pregnancy, diagnosing numerous pathogenic microorganisms, measuring the blood levels of various drugs, matching histocompatibility antigens, and detecting antigens shed from certain tumors. For example, monoclonal antibody to breast cancer cells is labeled with iodine-131 and it is introduced into the blood to detect the spread of tumor to regional lymph nodes. This monoclonal imaging technique can reveal breast cancer metastasis that would be undetected by other less sensitive scanning techniques. Third one is, they are often used for detecting and locating tumor antigens, permitting earlier diagnosis of some primary or metastatic tumors in patients. Fourth one is, monoclonal antibodies are highly specific and efficient in treating a disease. They can even differentiate two related diseases. Next one is, in immunotherapy, certain drugs or toxins are conjugated to monoclonal antibodies, which in turn deliver these substances to the tumor cells against which the antibodies are specifically directed. Next is, for certain research, diagnostic and therapeutic purposes, monoclonal antibodies which are derived from a single clone and thus specific for a single epitope are preferable. Now, due to their ability to bind and inhibit tumor necrosis factor alpha or TNF-alpha, monoclonal antibodies are found effective as an anti-inflammatory agent in certain autoimmune diseases like rheumatoid arthritis, Crohn's disease, ulcerative colitis, etc. Next is, immunotoxins composed of tumor-specific antibodies coupled to lethal toxins are potentially valuable therapeutic reagents. The toxins used in preparing immunotoxins include ricin, shigella toxin, and diphtheria toxin. All of these toxins inhibit protein synthesis. These toxins are so potent that a single molecule has been shown to kill a cell. Each of these toxins consists of two types of functionally distinct polypeptide components, an inhibitory toxin chain and one or more binding chain, which interact with the receptors on the cell surface. Without the binding of polypeptides, the toxin cannot get into the cells and therefore is harmless. There are advantages and disadvantages of monoclonal antibody. Few advantages are, it can produce large quantities of identical antibody. There will be batch-to-batch homogeneity, high specificity to single epitope, and reduced probability of cross-reactivity. It can provide better results in assays requiring quantification of protein levels. Few disadvantages are: small changes in the epitope structure often render the monoclonal antibody unable to detect the target protein. They are less efficient for detecting the protein in a denatured state or altered conformation. Coming to the conclusion, hybridoma technology is a method for producing large numbers of identical antibodies, also called monoclonal antibodies. Unlike polyclonal antibodies that arise from many B cell clones and have a heterogeneous collection of binding sites, a monoclonal antibody is derived from a single B cell clone and it is a homogeneous collection of binding sites. Monoclonal antibodies have a wide range of applications. To mention a few, they are used as diagnostic or therapeutic reagent, in detecting tumor antigens, and even in treating diseases. Thank you.